You're listening to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast network.
You're listening to DolphinsTalk.com Daily, the most listened to daily Miami Dolphins podcast on the internet. Come on, Dolphins fans. Time to fins up. Miami's got the Dolphins, the greatest football team. We take the ball from goal to goal like no one's ever seen. We're in the air, we're up. Hello, Miami Dolphins fans. How are you today? And thank you for listening to DolphinsTalk.com Daily. I am your host, Tom Ernesty. On today's show, we will review Mike McDaniel's press conference, what was said. We'll give you some injury updates, as well as thoughts on Liam Eichenberg's and the offensive line's performance against the Carolina Panthers. We're going to talk about the Miami Dolphins sitting at 5-1 with a lot of attention going to they haven't played anybody yet. So we're going to get into that. I got a lot to say in regards of those opinions that are being floated around, and also a small preview of the upcoming game on Sunday Night Football against the 5-1 Philadelphia Eagles. But before I get into that, I want to give a big shout out to everyone over at finheaven.com. Go to finheaven.com, the largest Miami Dolphins message board on the internet. And if you are on Facebook, go to the Facebook group, I Am a Miami Dolphins Fan, run by the great Carlos Hernandez. Phenomenal group of people over there. If you're on Facebook, go join the chats that they have. A lot of wide range of opinions when it comes to the Miami Dolphins on there. So if you want to be a part of that, just a couple quick questions you answer and you're in the group. All right, let's get this show on the road. Had a long travel day, so I am a bit tired, as most of you know. Or if you did not know, Mike Oliva and myself were in South Florida for the game against the Carolina Panthers. We were in the press box covering the game, and we had a fantastic time. We had a fantastic weekend. We got a chance to enjoy Fan Fest at Bow Campers in Fort Lauderdale. Saw a lot of great people, met a lot of fans of the Miami Dolphins and fans of the show, and we greatly appreciate each and every one of you who listen to our show. If you are new to our show, be sure to subscribe to the podcast. If you're listening on Apple, Podbean, Stitcher, Google Play, wherever you listen to your podcast, please subscribe to the channel and you will be alerted when new shows come out. And we greatly appreciate each and every one of you. All right, let's get into Mike McDaniel's press conference. First and foremost, we got to give some injury updates. Mike McDaniel was asked regarding Xavier Howard's further testing, did it reveal anything worrisome with the groin as far as potentially missing time? Also, was asked about running back Chris Brooks and his MRI and indicate that he could be out for a while. Mike McDaniel's response, in the particular cases that you speak of, I would say that X, Xavier Howard, is more day-to-day and Chris is more week-to-week, I would say. There's some swelling that has to go down with Chris before we can totally get a timeline or a rough estimation. We are going to see how X calms down and responds to treatment. Just normal weekly question marks that we have to figure out. So, how did I read this? Xavier Howard looks like his groin injury was something that he was already working on. Okay. The fact that he tweaked it in the game against Carolina and the fact that he's day-to-day, I would be shocked if he doesn't play against Philadelphia next week. Although this team has taken soft tissue injuries very serious in the early going this season, making sure they protect the players from themselves. Obviously, they're athletes. They want to be out there. They want to be playing every single game if they're banged up. Of course, this is big picture view, which is why we haven't seen guys like Connor Williams and Jalen Phillips not playing because of soft tissue injuries. Regarding Chris Brooks, if it is a week-to-week thing with his, it looks like it was his ankle, if it's a week-to-week thing, he will not be put on IR. And here's the reason why. If he's put on injured reserve to return, the Dolphins will only have one final spot to use. So if there's a potential injury long-term, for instance, Jalen Waddle or Tyreek Hill, they would have one spot available for two of those guys. And if one of those guys is out for a significant period of time, say past 4 or 5 weeks, they can't put him on IR. If they do, they're going to be out for the season. So Chris Brooks, in my estimation, will be still on the roster. Obviously, he's shown some value. I don't think they're just going to release him, even when Jeff Wilson, who I'll talk about here in a minute, I don't think they let him go. There's a lot that is going to be happening regarding roster moves. I don't think they're going to carry five running backs because we do have Devon Achane coming back after the bye week. So a lot of things that will be need to be discussed when it comes to Chris Brooks. So we'll monitor that and see how it goes. Jalen Phillips, who is coming off an oblique injury, Mike McDaniel was asked about snap count limitation and if he's still dealing with the oblique. He said yes to a varying degree. We try to be very intentional. When you get really good players on the field, your temptation is just to let him go. I know he wanted even more involvement than he got, speaking to who he is as a player and the type of mentality he brings. So we're trying to be concerted with the amount that he has got as to not overuse him. So he's still a little banged up, but he's getting some reps back. I think they will ramp him up again next week against Philadelphia, where he'll see more snaps. Jeff Wilson, he was projected to play this week, earlier in the week, but they listed him doubtful and then ruled him out on Saturday. He was asked in regards that they have 2 weeks to activate Jeff Wilson Jr. and what led to him not being put on the 53 this past weekend, and do you feel good about him being able to play this week? Now, again, Chris Brooks is not going to play. That's pretty clear at this point. So it's Raheem Mostert, Savon Ahmed, the two running backs. Mike McDaniel said that he was prepared enough to play, and going into the game plan and with regard to the entire team and the scope of what was going on with the team, it kind of necessitated us to have that spot directed somewhere else. I think he was more than prepared. We are very aware of the windows. We just have to be patient like a movie premiere. Well, patience is running out. In my opinion, patience is running out. Chris Brooks not going to be available. You're not going to just trot out two running backs, especially the way you've been running the football and being balanced on offense. So my thought is Jeff Wilson, who was limited all week in practice.
I didn't get that. Could you try?
Oh, Siri. Sorry about that. I think because he practiced all last week and he was ruled doubtful, I think, again, that was part of the game plan, not activating him on the 53. Now there's a chance they will activate him on the 53 going into the Philadelphia game. How much work he gets in that game is, we don't know yet. But the expectation is that he should be playing, and based on what Mike McDaniel did say, there is a strong possibility. Connor Williams, another guy for the Miami Dolphins who was held out this week after playing the full game against the Giants. They did not play him this week. He was asked if Connor Williams will be on track to practice, and Mike McDaniel said yes. He had a good weekend. Just because we try to protect players from themselves, I wouldn't be surprised if he didn't practice Wednesday, but that would be a day-to-day thing. He had a good weekend, although frustrated. He's one of the more frustrated players that doesn't play that I've been around. He gives you the worst look. He's mad at you that you are protecting him. So expect Connor Williams in practice this week, which leads me to the next topic. Liam Eichenberg, the man that Dolphins fans myself included, and I am on the record saying that this guy should not be playing professional football. He had a good, no, I wouldn't say good. He had a very good performance against the Carolina Panthers. Mike McDaniel was asked about Liam Eichenberg's second start at center. His response, quote, "I expected some comfort level in this game and him being able to execute some things that he may not have been able to from his first rep. It was pretty safe bet considering it was the first time ever that he had done that in a game. I saw really just him handling that position. It's such a communicative position, and there's a difference. Step one is making the right call before the snap. Step two is executing the snap, and step three is the actual play." Well, even before you get the ball snapped, your conviction and how you authoritatively make a declaration or set a combination target, that has implications. We could feel it during the week. We actually had guys mid-play celebrating his decisive call, and that manifests itself into the game. I thought his play, he blocked people well, but he also did his part to help others block their guys, as well as the appropriate communication decisiveness. All right. There are 32 dropbacks against Carolina. Liam Eichenberg gave up zero quarterback pressures, zero quarterback hits, and zero sacks. That is what the Dolphins want from a guy they've traded up into the second round to get. Now, this is a one-off performance. Liam Eichenberg has not been a consistent football player since he's been drafted. He's been awful, okay? Let's make that clear. But we have to give credit where credit's due. He did fantastic in his second start at center. Is he going to be long-term center? No. Connor Williams looks like he's going to be back, so Liam Eichenberg goes back to the bench. But there's a little bit of trust that's building with the offensive linemen, with the quarterback. I mean, watching the game in person yesterday, there were zero bad snaps. Everything was on target. Everything under center was clean. Anything in shotgun or pistol was clean. Everything looked good. So Liam Eichenberg deserves praise for his play. Let's move on to the Miami Dolphins being 5-1. And them being 5-1 has brought criticism from some media types on social media that they are a paper, quote unquote, paper champ, 5-1 because of who they've played. Okay? I'm recording this on Monday night. The Dolphins have played the 2-2 Chargers, the 1-5 Patriots, a 1-5 Denver Broncos, the 4-2 Buffalo Bills. They've lost that game. That's their only defeat. The 1-5 New York Giants and the 0-6 Carolina Panthers. I say this on the postgame show pretty much every week, knowing the teams that they've been going against. You never apologize for victories in the NFL. Never. I could give a damn who you're playing. Winning a Sunday football game, or Monday, depending on when you play, or Thursday, is important. And it doesn't matter if the team across from you is 6-0 or 0-6. Carolina came out yesterday and punched the Dolphins right in the mouth. 14-0 in the first quarter. And we saw the Dolphins handle their business to win 42-21. Now, certain fan bases, Buffalo and the New York Jets fans bases, said that the Dolphins haven't played anybody of substance, and they are not a real team because they haven't played anybody. Well, the Buffalo Bills went out on Sunday Night Football and laid an absolute dud against the Giants, who the Dolphins beat handily the week before. 31-13. And the Dolphins struggled in that game and dropped 31 points on the Giants. The Bills put up a measly 14 points and, dare I say, shouldn't even won that game because the refs swallowed their flag on the final play. Regarding the Jets, give kudos to where it's due. Their defense is fantastic. But because the defense has helped the offense, how many touchdowns have the Jets scored since Zach Wilson's become the quarterback of the team? Not a lot. Six? I think six total touchdowns offensively. And they've kicked like 13, 14 field goals. That team isn't good. Their defense is great. Their offense stinks. Oh, and by the way, the Bills have also played the Vegas Raiders, whom are 3-3, but they're not a very good football team. They've been very fortunate to come away with the wins that they've had. They play the New England Patriots this week, sitting at 1-5, going to Foxborough. Dolphins beat them on their home turf. It's nonsense that anybody could look at an NFL team and say they're not good because they haven't played anybody. They've played six teams, and they've won five. The Dolphins' schedule gets harder. It is the third toughest schedule going forward for the rest of the season. We know about the game against Philadelphia next Sunday. Then they play the Patriots and wrap up their season against them in week 8. They're a mess. They should win that game. Then they play the Kansas City Chiefs, who also sit at 5-1. After the bye week, the Dolphins get the Raiders, they get the Jets, they get the Commanders and the Titans. Raiders are 3-3. The Jets are 3-3. The Commanders are 3-3. The Titans are 2-4. Then they play the Jets again. So they're going to be playing some winning teams, teams that currently are 500 and winning football teams. Never apologize for winning. These five wins that the Dolphins have in the first six games is going to help them in the long run. So when looking at the schedule, can they beat Philly? Yes. Can they beat New England? Absolutely. Can they beat the Chiefs? Absolutely. Their offense can definitely do it. Let's say they go 2-1. Dolphins are 7-2 at the bye week. How many more wins, based on the way this conference is playing, do they need to get into the playoffs? My guess, 4. Get to 11. Is there 4 more wins on the schedule after the bye week? Raiders at home, Jets on the road, Commanders on the road, Titans at home, Jets at home. Can you find 4 wins out of those 5 games? Yep. Even if they go 3-2, they're at 10. Then finish with Dallas. Excuse me. You finish with Dallas, Baltimore, and Buffalo. Can you find another win out of those 3? Yep. So beating the opponent that you go against, doesn't matter their record, helps in the long run. That's what's important. I could give a damn who they've played. Fins up. Let's go to the conversation about the Philadelphia Eagles. But before I do that, we have to give a shout out to our sponsor, Caldera Lab. CalderaLab.com. Use the promo code DolphinsTalk and get 20% off your order. Guys, it is a woman, it's a women's world when it comes to skincare, but Caldera Lab caters to you, the man. They give you phenomenal products you have to use once in the morning and once at night. It starts with the clean slate, starts and ends your day. This face wash leaves all skin types refreshed. The base layer is the daily moisturizer to hydrate your skin and jumpstart your day full of confidence. And then you have the good, your go-to multifunctional serum at night that helps your skin look tighter and smoother. Also, the Icon Eye Serum is available, which addresses the three most common skin concerns around the eye, the fine lines, the circles, and the puffiness. Go to calderalab.com, use the promo code DolphinsTalk, and get 20% off your order. All right, Philadelphia went into the Meadowlands 5-0 and left 5-1. How did they lose to the Jets? Well, it starts with the pressure. Jalen Hurts was pressured more than 40% of his dropbacks. He is 3-7 as the starting quarterback of the Philadelphia Eagles when he is pressured more than 40% of his dropbacks. I hope Vic Fangio took note. Pressure, pressure, pressure. Find the way to get pressure into Jalen Hurts' face because he is prone to turnovers. The man had three interceptions, very costly ones, which I was stunned. On 3rd-and-9, near midfield, they decided to throw the ball instead of running it. I believe the Jets were out of timeouts at that point, or maybe they had one left. But even so, running the ball would force time off the clock. And you would imagine that Sirianni would look at it and go, this is Zach Wilson at quarterback. When has he had an opportunity or has he done anything to drive his team 80-plus yards to score a touchdown? They don't score touchdowns with Zach Wilson. So I was very shocked in the decision-making by Philadelphia. It came back and bit him in the ass. They also lost right tackle Lane Johnson to a pretty significant sprain of his ankle. Now, they haven't officially said anything regarding playing on Sunday, but the likelihood is if that man's not 100%, they're not going to put him out there against the Dolphins pass rush featuring Bradley Chubb, Jalen Phillips, or Andrew Van Ginkle. There's no way. So that would be a huge loss for Philadelphia if they do not have Lane Johnson. Also, this game gives the Miami Dolphins a chance to shred the narrative. The narrative that they can only beat bad teams and they lose to playoff caliber teams. The Eagles are Super Bowl caliber team. Can the Dolphins take care of business on Sunday night, get the much needed win to propel this team to greater heights? I would expect a very sound game plan. I would expect to see everything that we've seen over the course of 6 weeks regarding this offense. I expect they're going to try to run the football. Breece Hall had some success against the Eagles yesterday. I would expect they are going to try to keep the Eagles off the field as much as possible, so chew some clock up. Granted, that's very difficult with the Dolphins' offense because they score more touchdowns on, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8 play drives in less than 4 minutes. But they can put up points. We know that. They're going to have to against Philly. This is not the same Eagles team that we watched last year. They are struggling offensively. They still have studs at wide receiver. A.J. Brown, Devontae Smith, DeAndre Swift, Swifty back. Very shifty. He can find ways to break long plays. So Vic Fangio has his hands full. We will have shows for you each and every day this week, gearing you up for the game Sunday night. We'll have the pregame show as well as the postgame wrap-up show with Mike Oliva and myself very late at night breaking down the Eagles and Dolphins game. Hopefully, Miami Dolphins will get to 6-1 before they host the New England Patriots at home before traveling to Germany to take on the Chiefs. Thank you all for listening. Be sure to follow me on X, formerly known as Twitter, at Dolphins Talk Tom. Follow the main account at Dolphins Talk. Go to DolphinsTalk.com each and every day for all the latest Miami Dolphins news and information. If you are not subscribed to our YouTube channel, please go to YouTube, search Dolphins Talk. You subscribe to the channel and hit the alert bell if you want to know when we go live with shows, whether it's Mike or myself, whether it is the boys over at the Same Old Dolphin Show, Josh and Aaron. Please subscribe to the channel and smash the like button. We greatly appreciate it. I hope you all have a great day. And we'll talk to you again after a while. Fins up. Let's go.
Thank you for listening to the DolphinsTalk.com podcast. Be sure to visit DolphinsTalk.com every day for all of your latest Miami Dolphins news.